Sunday. I'm very excited that we are together today. Now, before I forget, I need to make a quick announcement that every Sunday we have Zoom together at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. There's also Zooms for other age groups as well, so if you have a brother or a sister in a different grade, they can come to Zoom as well. Please message us if you would like to know more about that. Okay, now it is time for me to ask you our question of the day. And my question of the day for you is, what is your favorite thing that you have ever learned? Think about everything you know. You know the alphabet, you know math, you know science. What's your favorite thing you've ever learned? I think you'll see why I ask that later. Now, let's change our green screen. I wonder why we have a mountain here. I bet we'll learn later. All right, everybody, let's pray. Father God, I thank you so much for the opportunity to learn together today. Thank you for your great love for us. Thank you that you are with us. And God, as we learn what Jesus taught his disciples, I ask that you would open our hearts and you would help us to learn it as well. Thank you that everything you do is right and good. And so I just ask that you would help us to learn to love you more and more. In your holy name we pray, amen. Great job, everybody. Okay, first things first, we've got to go through our scripture memory verse. Do you remember where it's from? This is our fourth week doing it, and it comes from Luke 4, 18 through 19. Let's read it together. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. So if this is your first week with us, that might seem like a whole lot of words. Each week when we learn our scripture memory verse, we put sign language to our verse to help us learn. So we'll go through it slowly. In this verse, it's very important to remember that Jesus is talking to a group of people, and he's reading from the book of Isaiah in the Old Testament. And the part that he's reading was actually a prophecy about Jesus himself. So this is a very special scripture. The first sign we're going to do is the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. You put one hand in the other and you say, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. For me, we do the sign for Jesus because he's the one talking. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Luke 4, 18 through 19. That was a very long, you know, sign language without stopping. We'll go a little slower now. The beginning we know pretty well. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Jesus is saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God is with me. But why was God with Jesus? Because he, God, has anointed me. God anointed Jesus. That means he set Jesus apart. He gave him a special job to bring good news to the poor. Jesus came to earth to give good news to poor people. Yeah? And without God, all of our hearts are poor, no matter how much money we have. The good news of Jesus is for everybody. Jesus came to do more than bring good news to the poor. Let's keep remembering what he said. He, God, has sent Jesus, has sent me, that's what the scripture says, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to set people free, and recovering of sight to the blind. Jesus was coming to give blind people their sight back, some people in their eyes, and lots of people in their hearts, and recovering of sight to the blind. to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That's Luke 4, 18 through 19. Round of applause. That was so good, you guys. All right, everybody, great job. Now it's time for us to jump into our lesson. Today's lesson takes place in the book of Matthew. So if you look in your table of contents, Matthew is the first book of the New Testament. Then you're going to find the big chapter 5, the big 5. And we're going to start at the beginning. But before we jump in, I want to read you a little bit of the end of Matthew chapter 4 so you kind of know what was going on in Jesus' life at this time. This was at the very beginning about of his ministry. So Jesus was a grown-up. This is Matthew 4, 23 through 25. And he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction among the people. So his fame spread throughout all Syria, and they brought him all the sick, those afflicted with various diseases and pains, those oppressed by demons, epileptics and paralytics, and he healed them. And great crowds followed him from Galilee and the Decapolis, and from Jerusalem and Judea, and from beyond the Jordan.
So Jesus was teaching everywhere. He was healing sick people. He was teaching the gospel to everyone who would listen. And more and more and more people wanted to meet Jesus. So when we get to Matthew chapter 5, we are learning a very important teaching that Jesus gave. It's from something called the Sermon on the Mount. And this little part we're talking about today are called the Beatitudes. Let's see what we can learn. Matthew 5 verse 1 says, "Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain. And when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying," phrase. So Jesus was up on the mountain, speaking so that everyone could hear him, right? So let's see what Jesus decided to teach the people on this specific day. Matthew 5 verse 2 says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Phrase. So blessed or blessed is a special word that means how our heart feels, right? So blessed, when you feel blessed, it's a little like feeling happy and it's a little like feeling joyful. But what it really means is that your heart is in the right relationship with God. So Jesus was talking and he was saying, these things that I'm going to teach you, your heart will be blessed or blessed if you do these things, which means you'll have the right relationship with God. So he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Poor in spirit is kind of a fancy way of saying that you know you need God. So Jesus is saying, blessed are the people out there who know they need God. They are poor in spirit. They know that without God, it's like they're empty. Yeah? And then he said, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus was kind of giving a cause and effect. Maybe you've learned that in school. Jesus was saying, if you are poor in spirit, if you know you need God, if you know that without God you are empty, yours is the kingdom of heaven. And that just means getting to be with God, right? The kingdom of heaven is wherever God is. Yeah? So, Jesus was going to make a list of things like that. So let's see what's next. Let's remember that the first thing he said is, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So that's one thing Jesus wants us to be. He wants us to be poor in spirit. He wants us to know that we need God. Let's see what he said next. Verse 4 says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. So maybe you've heard the word mourn. Mourn can mean like sad, be sad. But Jesus wasn't just talking about being sad about any old thing, like being sad that you're out of ice cream or your favorite football team lost a game. Jesus was saying that blessed are those who mourn, who feel sad about sin, for they will be comforted. Yeah, Jesus wants us to understand how bad sin is and he wants it to make our heart sad. So blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who know they need God. And blessed are those who mourn sin, for they will be comforted. Yeah, Jesus wants us to look at sin and think, ugh, that is the worst, and feel sad about it. Like when I sin, Jesus wants me to be sad about my sin. He doesn't want me to say, eh, it wasn't that bad. It doesn't really matter. No, Jesus wants me to mourn my sin in my heart. Because when I mourn my sin, he will comfort me and forgive me when I ask for forgiveness, right? Let's see what's next. Verse 5 says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. A meek person is a gentle person, a person who puts others first, a person who does not think very highly of themselves. Yeah? So we've seen that Jesus wants us to be poor in spirit. He wants us to mourn our sin, and he wants us to be meek. Let's see what's next. Verse 6 says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. So, righteousness is a very big word that means that you want God's way to be the right way. Yeah? You don't want people to be mean to people. You don't want people to steal things. When we want God's righteousness, we want his law to be followed. So Jesus is saying, it's like you're hungry or you're thirsty, not for food or water, but for the law of God to be right. Yeah? Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Jesus wants us in our life to work to do God's law because we love Jesus, not because we want to be the best or because we want to be perfect. No, we should hunger and thirst for righteousness because that's what makes God happy when we love him enough to try to do his law. And we're not going to do it perfectly. We're going to sin. We're going to forget things. But the point is, Jesus wants us to live our lives loving God and seeking to do what he tells us to do. He tells us to follow his law, so we should try. Yeah, that's what righteousness means. Let's see what's next. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. This one is wonderful. Merciful means being kind and loving and forgiving. God has given us mercy. He forgives us. He loves us. Yeah? We don't deserve those things, but he gives his mercy and grace to us freely. And so the Bible, this verse is saying, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Jesus is saying if we can be merciful to people in our world, God will give us mercy. Yeah? That's very important to Jesus. Let's see what's next. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. To be pure in heart means that you are trying to live your life for Jesus, trying to follow his law, trying to do all these things. Guys, all these things are like kind of mixed together, right? To want righteousness, to try to follow God's law, you kind of need God's help to be pure in heart. And to be pure in heart will help you to be meek or will help you to be poor in spirit, right? All of these things are connected, and they're all pretty big words, but Jesus is listing these behaviors to show us how we should behave so that we can know God better. And we won't always be perfect, but this is a great sort of goal to have. Like, I'm gonna try to live this way because I love Jesus. Yeah? When Jesus saves us from our sin and gives us a new heart, we don't want to live the way we used to live. We want to live this way, the way that Jesus tells us is right. Yeah? Let's see what's next after pure in heart. Verse 9 says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." So when you're a peacemaker, when you try to bring peace, you're trying to bring God's love and peace to everybody. In our world, peace has a lot of definitions, but the way Jesus is talking about it is that we're going to bring God's peace to those around us. Yeah? Let's see what's next. The last two verses, last three verses, are a little serious. It says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Okay, so in these last few verses, Jesus is telling us something important. Being Christians in this world will not always be easy. In America, we have freedom of religion, so life here isn't too hard for us. But there are other places in the world where you could go to jail for believing in Jesus, or you could get hurt for believing in Jesus. Here in America, that probably won't happen to us. But going to jail or being hurt, that's what persecute means. When it says, "Blessed are you who, when others revile you and persecute you," or "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus was saying that some people in this world, maybe all of us, at some point will face people who don't like that we love Jesus. I think the one time that's happened to me quite a few times in my life. I've never gone to jail or been physically hurt for loving Jesus, but my feelings have been hurt. One time I was with a group of people and they said some really mean things to me because they knew I believed in Jesus, and it really hurt my feelings. They did not think that I was smart for believing in Jesus. They did not think that I was right to believe in Jesus, and they called me names. Now, that is not the worst persecution, but that shows me that what Jesus was saying is true. It's going to happen in our lives that people won't like that we love him. But how should I react? Should I have reacted and been mean back and said, "You're wrong, I don't like you"? No. Jesus has just listed all of these behaviors that show me how to react. Blessed are the merciful. I should be merciful and kind to those people. Blessed are the peacemakers. I should show peace in my interactions with those people. Blessed are those who mourn. I should mourn my own sin and mourn that these people don't know Jesus. You know? So I guess all I'm trying to say is, in your life, you might not go to jail for believing in Jesus or get hurt for believing in Jesus, but chances are at some point, your feelings will get hurt. And how you react will show people the love that Jesus has given you. And Jesus has just given us a lot of good ideas about how to respond when we meet people who do not love him. Yeah? If you look in verse 13, it says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored?" You guys know salt? Have you ever had like French fries with salt on it or some food with salt on it? And you know how the salt kind of tastes really good? Jesus is saying that Christians are like the salt of the earth. In how we act and how we behave, it can show people Jesus. Just like if you eat a French fry and it's salty, you can understand the salt. If we go out in the world and show people Jesus' love, some people will recognize it, kind of like salt. It's kind of a funny metaphor, but I really like it because I like salt. Then Jesus gives a different metaphor. Verse 14 says, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Jesus is saying, hey, you guys, you know the truth. You know that God is real. You know that Jesus came to die on the cross for your sins and rise again. That makes you like a bright light to show people the way. You know that song, This Little Light of Mine, I'm Gonna Let It Shine? You know that song? It's talking about Jesus. If you know something, like the truth about Jesus, are you gonna hide that away? No, you're gonna let it shine. You're gonna tell your friends, you're gonna tell your family. When people persecute you or make fun of you or tease you, you're not gonna let it get you down. You're just gonna keep praying. You're going to say, Jesus, help me keep shining your light. You guys, Jesus is the light of the world. He has given us his light, and he wants us to tell everybody we know the truth of the gospel. When Jesus preached all of this on the mountain to all of his friends, all of the people who wanted to learn from him, he was showing them more of who God is. God wants us to be poor in spirit. Yeah, he wants us to mourn our sin. He wants us to be meek. He wants us to hunger and thirst for righteousness. He wants us to be merciful and pure in heart. He wants us to be peacemakers. When we do those things because we love Jesus, he will help us do them better. And in doing those things, we are like the salt of the earth. We are like a light shining on a hill. Yeah, Jesus helps us do those things. We don't do them by ourselves, but we do them because we love him and because we want the whole world to know who Jesus is. I love this lesson. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for helping us learn the Beatitudes and the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus, please help us to understand that you spoke these words to teach us how we should live. You've given us new life. You've given us changed hearts. So please help us behave the way you want us to, out of love for you, God. We know you love us no matter what. Thank you for loving us when we behave this way and when we don't behave this way. Thank you that you never leave us no matter what. Help us to understand that you are the Savior of the world. And when you help us behave in these ways, we show who you are to everyone around us. God, we pray for the people in our lives who do not know you, and we ask that you would help them understand who you are. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for showing us the truth of your gospel. In your holy name we pray, amen. Great job, everybody. Next week, we're gonna learn another wonderful story about Jesus. And in the meantime, I hope that this week, as you go through your week, you remember how much God loves you, and that you allow that to impact how you behave. Yeah, I am gonna try my best. Let's see, I'm gonna think about this list. I think on this list, I want to think about being poor in spirit. I want to think about how much I need God. And I'll circle back with you next week about how that went. All right, you guys, have a great week. Thank you for learning with me, and I'll see you next time. Bye!